It is God who brings about the results of the prayer. But God invites us to join Him in believing prayer. And many of us miss the power of God because we don't understand that theological point of prayer. Look at James chapter 5, verse 16 on the screen as well. Therefore, confess your sins to one another. Lord Jesus, I could spend the rest of the day on those words. Sin? Me? And then secondly, sin? Me tell somebody else? Are you serious? Well, I am serious, but I'm not the one who matters. God is serious. Look what he says. Confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. And the effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. In fact, I'm stopping and praying right now. Lord Jesus, you have given me this message. And God, I'm about to lose my voice. I'm asking you in the name of Jesus, Lord, keep my voice together so I can deliver this today. In Jesus' name, amen. The effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. So notice something. You need to get this. Effective prayer is accomplished by a clearly defined kind of person in the Bible. Now, a lot of us will just say, well, I'm just going to believe in faith and God will do it. Well, that's not all the Bible says. The Bible says in the verse that we just read that effective prayer is accomplished by a clearly defined kind of person. Now, theology of prayer says there's more to it than acts, confession, right? There's more to it than that. And we're learning that. Look at this. This is in the context, James, that we're reading right now, is in the context of asking God for something. This time, it's wisdom. But the truth is, it could be anything in this context. But he's saying, if you lack wisdom, let him ask. So what is that kind of person that's defined in the Bible? What kind of person can really experience the power and the presence of God through believing prayer? Is that an important question? What kind of person is revealed in the Bible that can experience the power and the presence of believing prayer? Is that an important question? Yes. Here we go. The Bible says it's an authentic, transparent person. An authentic, transparent person. A lot of our young adults are sitting over here. I am so glad that I'm not, and not all of them are in this category, I am so glad that I am not in the millennial camp. Let me just tell you why. And some of you are over here as well. Because you have been told who you are by the culture. We have so painted you with such a broad brush, which is so unfair. But I will say this. The pressure for you to create an image of who you are on social media is insane. Absolutely insane. Now, with that broad brush, we're told that you desire authenticity, maybe above all else, right? Whereas we boomers, no. No, we want to just fool everybody and get what we want because we deserve it all. But I'm told, and all the people who study this say that you have a desire for authenticity. All right. But then you're under this pressure to create this alternative reality on social media. And by the way, it's not just our millennials who are under this pressure. It's all of us that engage in social media. Stay with me on this. And yet God's word is clear that it's an authentic, transparent person that actually experiences this power and presence of God through believing prayer. You say, where do you see that? Because the Bible says, listen, listen carefully, therefore confess your sins to one another. Now, this alternative image that we're creating is literally the polar opposite of being authentic and transparent and confessing your sins to one another. Because we all live under pressure where we, I'm going to say it again. First of all, I'm not even sure how aware we are that we have sin, and yet God's word says that if we say we have no sin, we're a liar and the truth's not in us. But honestly, folks, do you ever hear anybody talking about sin anymore? Do you have people coming up to you and say, listen, I'm really battling sin in my life. Would you pray for me? Do you hear that very often? I'm going to tell you, as a pastor, I rarely, if ever, hear that. It's always, I got a problem, I've got a dilemma, but I don't hear that. And so it's almost as though in the modern church we've abandoned this most basic fundamental principle. And then if we are dealing with sin personally, I wouldn't dare let anybody know about it and have them pray for me. Why? Because then I'd have to come up with a fake Tony Lambert account on Twitter. It'd be like the fake Dr. Tony Lambert. Or my face. I'd have to come up with, why? Because I wouldn't want anybody to know that. My word. I've created this. Is anybody listening? And so the church has lost the power and the presence of God because we lack the authenticity and transparency. We don't want anybody to know that we're struggling. You know, when I first moved here 5 and a half, close to 6 years ago, I could get up without using my hand from here. So effective prayer is accomplished by a clearly defined kind of person. That person is authentic and transparent. And then look at James chapter 1. Back up just a little bit. Verse 5. Look at this. James chapter 1. It's on the screen. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But he must ask in faith, without any doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For that man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord. Why? Because he's double-minded. He's unstable in all his ways. So a specific, clearly defined kind of person will experience through believing prayer the power and the presence of God. A person who is transparent. A person who is authentic. And then the Bible says a person of faith. A person of faith. It's right there in the verses that we just read. And there's so many levels here. That implies relationship with Jesus Christ. Remember that you're not going to get anything from God unless you get it through Jesus Christ, and you have to have that relationship. The own words of Jesus, he said, you must be born again if you'll ever see the kingdom of God. So it implies relationship with Jesus Christ. It implies consistency without doubting. Because if you doubt, come on, folks. If you doubt, you're like a ship tossed by the wave. I mean, you're just up and down and so wishy-washy. And so a clearly defined individual who's going to experience this power and presence of God is a person who will be a person of faith. Most of all, believing in the Lord Jesus Christ as the only Savior of the world and yours personally. Verse 5:16, back to that. The effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. So it tells me it's a transparent, it's an authentic person. It tells me it's a person of faith, and it tells me it's a righteous person. We sang about my righteousness this morning as Ethan led us. And our righteousness comes through the person of Christ. We are clothed in his righteousness. Listen to what the scripture says about Elijah, chapter 5 of James, verse 17. We're still in that context of James. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. Have you ever read about Elijah? I want to say to God, no way! Come on, God, I'm nowhere like this dude. I mean, this man is amazing. God, you know me. I'm weak. I'm frail. I'm all those things. The nature like us is that he was susceptible to all sin. He had struggles just like you and I do. He had a nature just like ours, the Bible says. And yet look at this. He prayed earnestly, verse 17 of chapter 5 of James. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain. There it is on the screen. And it did not rain on the earth for 3 years and 6 months. How many times have you had that kind of powerful believing prayer in your life? I mean, have you ever asked God to shut down the rain and he did? Don't raise your hand. Maybe you have. I don't know. If that's you during the summer months in Colorado, could you pray us down a little more rain? So I wouldn't have to hear the weather people say the world is about to end every summer. We're all going to die. We don't have any moisture. You know, it's like, really? The next week we'll get like 30 inches. 2 days later, we're in a drought again. You know, it's like, really? Come on. I know it's important. I'm not saying it's not important. But look at this. And then he prayed again, and the sky poured rain on the earth, and the earth produced its fruit. So the next one would be a persistent person. What kind of clearly defined person can experience believing prayer? It's a persistent person. The Bible says he prayed earnestly. The word there in the Greek is prosyuche. It means praying within prayer, earnestly, consistently. Maybe it's praying without ceasing. Maybe it's walking in such a relationship and sensitivity to the Holy Spirit, which you can't have if you're putting stuff in your system that desensitizes you to the Holy Spirit. But if you're walking in consistency with the Holy Spirit, and you can be just sort of sensitive and praying in everything that you do. Wow. See, the reason some of you are bored out of your gourd right now, you don't have that kind of relationship with God. And you hate this. There's some of you sitting here right now, you cannot wait till you get out of here. You just can't wait till you get on with your day and your life. And some of you, frankly, are probably saying, and if I get out, I ain't coming back. Now, some of you got parents here and you don't have that choice yet. Because you just, this is foreign to you. I am speaking a foreign language, and your heartbeat is not increasing. Your passion is not building. It's just all lifeless words to you. Because you don't have that earnest relationship with God. Because you've been sold a bill of goods. You've bought some cheap imitation. And honestly, I don't know this, but you may want to look deeply even at your salvation. He prayed earnestly. Can I just tell you? I pray earnestly. And can I tell you, this believing prayer thing is a challenge for me because sometimes I think God doesn't answer my prayers. There, I said it. Even though I told you that I don't think that's true. Theologically, I know that he answers my prayer, but there's sometimes I get defeated and I feel like God doesn't answer my prayers. Sometimes he does, very specifically. And to pray earnestly means you're going to pray specifically. What does that mean? It means ask him something. Get over this lame stuff of God bless my family. Well, what does that mean? If their hair doesn't all fall out, he's blessed them? What does that mean? They don't have a car wreck going home from church, he's blessed them? Is that what that means? Or do we ask God specifically anything? Wednesday, in prayer, crying out to God, longing for the presence of God, like I told you I've been doing. I begged God to give us 50 people in Trailhead Wednesday night. He didn't. In fact, we had about half that, so I guess I'm a half righteous man. Come on, you should have laughed at that. And can I tell you, I came up here just knowing that there were going to be 50 people. Now look, we got students going on, we got children going on, we got choir going on, we got all kind of stuff going on. But I wanted 50 adults in that room to worship. We didn't have 50. It was a down crowd. And can I tell you, for 5 or 10 minutes as the worship was going on, I was trying to find my resignation letter.
I'm a failure.
You know? God didn't answer my prayers. God doesn't love me. I'm not even saved. I'm going to hell. I know I am. I can just tell. God doesn't hear me, you know? But can I tell you, back this summer when we had the sports and crafts camp, I'd asked God for weeks to send us 100 kids. Do you know what God did? God sent us 100 kids. I can't explain that. I can't explain that to you. But you know what? I'm going to consistently, earnestly, specifically continue to ask. Hey, look, I'm not even going to bring up the house thing. I got no answers. I'm going to let God be God. But I'm going to do all that I can within the power and the grace of God, and by His power, let me say it again, by His power, I'm going to ask Him to move in my life in great and mighty way through believing prayer. Look at this. But even this person has no ability to accomplish anything unless God intervenes. I was talking with Landis yesterday about this and the theology of this, and asking him some questions. And I actually texted Ethan as well, and he's out like a crazy man running. And nobody was chasing you. I don't understand that. You were still running. Like, why? I don't get that. But anyway, so he didn't respond. But Landis and I were talking about that. And the thing we decided, we just know that, listen, you've heard it said before, work like it all depends on you and pray like it all depends upon God. And I was asking Landis, I was saying, is that theologically sound? Is that correct? I've heard it all my life. And I think we both decided that it was. But it was God that was even moving in our prayer as well as our work. It's still God that's answering all these things. So even if this person has no ability to accomplish anything unless God intervenes, look at this. In every record in the Bible, it was God who acted with power and provision in answer to prayers. In every record in the Bible, it was God who acted with prayer and provision in answer to the prayers. Remember our three concepts last week? I touched on them. I'm going to kind of sprint here to the end now. Remember those three concepts concerning providence, preservation, governance, and concurrence? We talked about those, and again, I mentioned them earlier. We're looking at concurrence right now. But what does the Bible say about the other two as related to a theology of prayer? Just very quickly, look at this. Romans 8, verse 26. You all know this verse. Here it is. In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness. On the screen, for we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because He intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. That's governance. That's God's providence working in our prayer through governance. Even when we can't pray, even when we're gumming it up, God works through our prayer life. He's praying for us. He's praying for us. Does that mean, oh, great, I'll just kick back and continue to do what I've been doing, which is almost nothing? No, that's not what God is saying. God is calling you to join Him in experiencing His presence and power through believing prayer. But you can have confidence today when you're not even sure how to pray, when you don't have the strength to pray, when you're so broken and hurting and distressed with life, God is praying on your behalf. Look at Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25. Therefore, He is able also to save forever those who draw near to God through Him, since He always lives to make intercession for them. That's the preservation of God in providence. So we've got concurrence, we've got governance, we've got preservation. Our theology is being built, it's being strengthened, and our confidence is always and totally in God. God invites us to bring everything to Him, literally into His presence, every concern of our lives. God says, I'll take it all if you'll come to me through believing prayer. If we miss something, not if we abandon the practice, but if we miss something, God has us covered. Amen? Amen. Is that a big deal? It's a huge deal. So let me close with this concept. Do we have a New Testament model of a prayer gathering? Do we have a New Testament model of a prayer gathering? Look, folks, I hope you've not heard an ounce of guilt in this message. Because I put this together, I mean, I promise you, as the Lord was directing me, I don't hear anything from the Lord saying, you should feel guilty, you low-life sinner, you. I don't hear that at all. I think our God is inviting us to experience the power and the presence of Himself through believing prayer. But notice this. There is a New Testament model. Does it look like what we do in our prayer gatherings? By the way, you have about 4 prayer gathering options every week that I'm aware of. There's a group that prays on Wednesday night. A group of men and a group of women prays every Wednesday night starting at 6 o'clock. They meet over in the chapel of the trailhead. They pray every Wednesday night. Now, there's some pockets of people who are praying throughout the week as well, and I can't list all those. I also know that on Sunday mornings at 8:30, right out here in this foyer, which is the coffee shop foyer area, there's a group of people. It's anywhere from this morning 10, sometimes it's 30, 35 people gather, have a quick prayer, and just walk out throughout the campus just praying as they go. Not out loud, not in front of anybody, just praying as they go. That's another one. Every Sunday morning, we start this service with prayer. You have the opportunity to get up, come, get on your knees before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and cry out to God on behalf of this earth. Those are just a few that I'm aware of. You have those opportunities. But do they look anything like the New Testament? Acts chapter 4, beginning with verse 23. You'll need to turn there. Acts chapter 4, verse 23. The Holy Spirit has come. The power is available to every believer. And here we go. When they had been released, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And when they heard this, they lifted their voices to God with one accord and said, O Lord, it is you who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the Holy Spirit, through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said, why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples devise futile things? Now pay attention here as we get into verse 26. The kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against His Christ. For truly in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your purpose predestined to occur. Notice what happens here in this prayer. New Testament model of this kind of believing prayer. Notice this, there's an acknowledgement of His divine hand. An acknowledgement of His divine hand. Do you see God's divine hand providentially working in every area of your life? Do you? Or have you become blind to it? Skeptical to it? Cold to it, desensitized to it. In this New Testament prayer gathering, there was an acknowledgement of His divine hand. The issue could be that we're too dependent on our ability. We don't acknowledge our need for God until the crisis hits. But they were thanking God for His divine hand. Look at verse 29. And now, Lord, take note of their threats and grant that your bondservants may speak your word with all confidence. While you extend your hand to heal and signs and wonders take place through the name of your holy servant Jesus. Look what they're doing. There's an acknowledgement, listen, of his divine hand, and then there is an asking for his powerful presence. An asking for his powerful presence. And now, Lord, take note of their threats and grant your bondservants may speak your word with all confidence while you extend your hand to heal and signs and wonders take place through the name of your holy servant Jesus. There was an asking for his powerful presence. Then verse 31. And when they had prayed, it's on the screen. The place where they had gathered together was shaken. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And what's the manifestation of that? The primary manifestation of being filled with the Holy Spirit? They began to speak the word of God with boldness. Believing prayer acknowledges his divine hand. Believing prayer asks for his power. And believing prayer experiences a great, mighty move of God. I want to say it this way. Look at the screen. We will not experience a great move of God or speak the word of God boldly until we first develop believing prayer. You cannot skip this step and have our world shaken by the power and presence of God. I asked our staff, I think it was Tuesday morning, I said, how many of you have ever been a part of a body of believers that was so aware of the presence of God that there was actually confession of sin to one another? And I think out of all our team, two people raised their hand. I asked them several other questions. I said, have you ever been a part of a church where people got there so early they saved seats just because they were afraid they weren't going to be able to get in the room? Because of the presence of God. Not because of the show or the sage on the stage, but because of the presence and the power of God. And again, there was just one or two out of our entire team. We desperately need to develop believing prayer. And I don't know what else to do but to invite you to start today. Knowing that the Bible says it is a clearly defined kind of person that will experience the presence and the power of God. Clearly defined in Scripture. Not because we do a lot of cool stuff, not because we're totally renovating and changing and adjusting, not because of any of that, but because we develop a bold, believing prayer life. Some of you are there. I know that. You're what sustains the ministry known as Riverside. But that kind of relationship to God, for too many of us probably in the room and those who will hear this message after today, too many of us, that's really a foreign concept to us. So, church, let's pray. Well, let's just start asking God to, within us, develop that kind of prayer life. Would you join me in that this morning?